evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out to our third quarter town hall. Really nice to see everybody here tonight. I'm Randall Balkum, I'm the CFA Public Affairs Officer. And at this time, we'll kick it off with Captain Lissel.
Yeah, good evening, CFA. Captain Lissel again, and really glad to speak with you today. I think what you're going to find here is that we have a lot of really great people working really hard, doing super things. And we're really glad to do it for the community. Before I turn this over to Commander Sherrard to talk about all the public works projects we have, the construction, the ventilation in the Prairie Gym, which we paid for a year ago, and it's been planned, and construction's going to start, I promise, just hang in there with us. I'd like to yield the floor to Captain Blair Hines from the hospital so he can bring us all to speed on a few things.
Thanks. Hey, real quick, I just want to talk about three topics tonight. One is flu shots. So we have a good plan for flu shots this year. It actually went very well last year for those of you who were here last year. We've just added a few extra people to make it go even smoother this year. We're looking to do flu shots the last week of September. We've got some nice flyers we're going to put up and everything that's got all the dates and times. They're going to mostly on this base be out of Prairie Gym, although there will be some at Ikango as well. However, we don't actually have the flu shots in our possession yet. So we're told they're going to send them to us, but we're just not going to send out the dates until we actually have them in our possession. So stand by. I believe we're going to go the last week of September. And there's a big plan. We're going to get all the operational forces units, as well as all the other SOFA members that live on this base, and Ikeo. The second thing is we have another large mass casualty event that's going to happen the first week of October. Okay, it's going to be the 3rd through the 5th. And we are looking for some volunteers to help us out with that. We had some folks help out last year and be casualties. They got some nice moulage. They had, you know, fake broken arms and fake broken legs and things like that. The drama team at the high school helped us out, some other people. And so we put out a flyer on our webpage. We're going to keep putting that out. And so if you're interested in participating, there's some contact information. We'd love to have some people join us and help us out with that. In addition to that, we are trying to build a larger walking blood bank than we actually have here. And so we're trying to expand that to community members who are interested in donating blood in a crisis situation. It'd have to be a very large crisis. You can use your imagination. But we would like to expand that beyond just my hospital members. And so that'll be part of that as well. There'll be some information coming out for anyone who's interested in being part of that community walking blood bank that expands our capabilities if there were to be, let's say, a large earthquake or something like that. We needed more blood than just my staff could provide. The third thing I want to talk about is MHS Genesis. That is the new electronic health record. It's not quite as new anymore. I'm doing it for the second time. I did it in Bremerton, Washington in 2019. It's just taking this long to get overseas. So October 28th, we will shift on that day from the legacy health record that we've used my entire career to the new Genesis electronic health record. I've used it, like I said, I used it several years ago in Bremerton, Washington, when I was stationed there. It's a fantastic system. It's much more capable. Once you start using it, you will find as a consumer that it has a lot more available to you. And the trick is, it is significantly more complicated. So my staff is figuring out how to use it. I actually had 6 hours of training today. I got trained on it as well as a provider. And so we're kind of going through that over the next couple of months. So we're getting up to speed with it, but appointments will probably be a little bit slower the next couple of months as we make sure we document things accurately. In order to make online appointments or access your information online in the new system, you will need a different login called a DS login. The information, if you're coming from the States, you're probably used to using that because Genesis has been in the States for a couple of years now. It's just coming here. If you've been here, you probably do not have one of those logins. The information for that is on some flyers that we've got posted on our Facebook page. We've posted it on the CFA Facebook page. I know not everybody likes Facebook, so I printed out some flyers. I have some flyers here. If anybody wants to come take one, it's just a printout of what's on Facebook. And it talks to you about how to get a new login. The login's not going to do much for you until October 28th, so you got some time, but you'll want to have that login on October 28th so you can access the system. If you don't, it's okay. You'll just have to go get one in November or whenever you get around to it, but you'll need that login to access the new system because the other stuff will be a legacy system at that point, and the login's not going to do anything for you. So those are the three things: flu shots, casualty exercise, first week of October, and MHS Genesis. Thank you for your time. I've got some flyers if anybody wants it afterwards. Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Well, good evening. I'm Commander Sharar, the Public Works Officer. I'll take you through two topics tonight that have been pretty high bids around the base. So we have a lot of construction and activity on this base. A lot of new buildings under construction, a new high school, and then just the normal activity. That's causing a lot of wear and tear on the road. So you may notice potholes and other things, issues with the road. Please do report them. Call 243-5555. First step is knowing where they are, and then we can troubleshoot and see how to fix them. We also had some bigger issues. So the pictures here is two recent sinkholes where the utilities under the road caved in and started sucking away the dirt. And that's called a sinkhole. So we have to fix the utility line first, and then we can pack back in the dirt and repave it. We're also doing significant work around the base. We've been designing it last year, where the construction is starting this summer. So you'll see some of those areas you may recognize getting painting and curbs, or actually repaving the whole area. So a lot by the community side, Forestall Road by the Blue Ridge, and then San Diego Street by the Oak Club and PSD area, and Clement Boulevard, the main road in front of McDonald's, as well as a few parking lots there like the theaters. So please bear with that as we shift routes and such to allow those improvements to happen. And again, please do report anything you see so we can keep it safe and get it fixed. Second topic is AC. I know it's always a long, hot summer here in Yokosuka, so I want to introduce you a little of how the ACs work and then some improvements we're making. So on the left, the first type of system is very common, called a split unit. You see the little units on the outside of the building. Inside, you usually have a control per room, and the occupant tends to like this system because they can turn on the heat, they can turn on the air, they can set the temperature depending on how it's programmed. Generally, these work very well. What they do is they recirculate the air in the room. So they'll just suck the air out of the room, turn it hot or cold, and spit it back out. Generally speaking, a different system will put fresh outdoor air in the building. So these get to end of life, and sometimes they just can't be maintained anymore, and we just replace the little unit, either inside or outside. The second type of unit is more for a large building called variable air volume. So a large centralized mechanical system like a boiler or a chiller, like a chiller will cool water. That water goes over to the air ducting, it will cool the air, and then we blow that air through large ducts. That's like a central AC in a house. And so what's challenging about these is they're very large systems. They're maintained and controlled in the mechanical room. And if a certain component is getting old, it can make the whole building harder to balance and use. Also, if there's construction and remodeling in your facility, like putting up walls and cutting up new rooms, sometimes the AC doesn't keep pace with that. So you might have one room a little hotter, one room a little colder, and we can do our best to try and balance that, but it's challenging to keep up with the lifespan of a building. Generally speaking, there's less occupant control and generally less satisfaction of the occupants because you don't have the individualized control. We are investing in these systems all around base. So I want you to know we're doing $100 million currently through next year, replacing these systems, major renovations and replacements. So Purdy Gym is often talked about. We awarded it almost a year ago. It's been designed all year. It's going to mobilize for construction here this winter. Some headquarters buildings like SRF and Command Hill, as well as some of the fleet side. So Fleet Theater is getting a new air handler. That R22 project is a new chiller for the Duncan CDC. We recognize that system is getting old and hot. The McDonald's and Starbucks got a few systems this year and a few more next year, as well as the Akego townhouse renovations all include their mechanical systems. So a significant amount of investment to keep up with the size of this base, and we understand the hot, humid temps. The main feedback I'm seeing this year is a lot of people having issues with water related to their system. So if you have a split unit on your wall and you're seeing dripping, please call us. Sometimes those drain lines get clogged up and we can clean the drain line out. If you're seeing water in other places, sometimes it's condensation. So if you set cold temp inside and hot air outside, you might get water around the edge of a door or window, or sometimes in the overhead. But also it can sometimes be leaks from the pipes, and we have to inspect for leaks. And if it's condensation on the pipes, we wrap them to try and hold that water. But please do report water leaks because it can turn into mold if not dealt with. So with that, appreciate your time, and I'll turn it over to Ryan Knight.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Marissa Niner, and I'm Acting at 9 currently, so I'll give you an update about what's going on in our world. So starting off with Fleet Family Readiness, we have a lot of events coming up. We're really thrilled to bring them to everyone here. So coming up in September, next week is our Ombudsman Appreciation Dinner on the 15th. Please remember, that tomorrow is the last day to buy tickets for that. So if you need to buy your ticket, go ahead and snag that tomorrow. Next day, on the 16th, we're having our modeling fair at Purdy Gym. And then the following week, on the 21st, our Bells Across America event at Cassano Park. In October, it is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, so we have a couple events going on. Our family movie night on the 1st, and then on the 25th, we're doing our Walk a Mile in Their Shoes event as well. Moving on to MWR, a couple of reminders. We're currently working on our family care plan so that we can better support our families here at Yokosuka should our sailors deploy and they need to enact those care plans. So please work with your commands and your families to get those updated and get us a copy so that we can help you guys out as well. And then fitness center updates, obviously we touched on our HVAC, but we have brand new equipment across all of our fitness centers, so we hope you are enjoying that as of August 2023. And then a reminder, please just wear closed-toed shoes when you're in our facility for your safety. A couple events that are coming up, Yokosuka Friendship Day, save the date, it'll be October 15th. We're really excited to open our gates and invite our neighbors to join us on the base for a lot of fun. We're going to have ship tours, our static displays, live entertainment, food and beverage, and of course vendors and kids and family activities. So please come on out and join us. And of course, Fall Festival on the 27th of October. That'll be a base event as well, and we're going to have a lot of fun fall Halloween themed activities, our zombie 5K for our youth, and our trunk or treat event, as well as live entertainment, food and beverage, and carnival activities. And then moving along to housing, we are currently in progress of our congressionally mandated third-party inspection. So you've probably been scheduled already. If you have any issues with your appointment, please contact housing so they can reschedule you. And we really appreciate everyone's cooperation as we're finishing these up. And then we also have some ongoing projects as well with our townhomes. Of course, Ikego is still ongoing, all of our renovations out there. We have some future projects going on as well out there. But we are also replacing items here on our townhomes, both backyard fencing, and our doors and windows here on Main Base as well. So we appreciate everyone's cooperation as we're going through those items. And then I know Ian will touch more, but typhoon preparedness, please just make sure you have emergency ready kits. Thank you very much. I'll turn it over to security.
Hey, good evening. Master Blakely with the security department. So ongoing focus of attention are school safety zones. School safety zones and parking enforcement. The school safety zones, we have areas where we have unauthorized drop-off and pickup zones. The first reason is for smoothness of traffic flow, right? But more importantly than that is the safety of students. So expect to see additional police patrols out there during pickup and drop-off hours. We're going to be working closely with the DA to ensure we come up with additional mitigations for safety as well. For parking lots to include the next commissary, post office, or any other service areas. Those parking lots are designated for customer service and not for long-term parking. So expect to see continued enforcement in those areas as well. All right, so over the summertime, we had a big push to take a look at abandoned vehicles. With a lot of upcoming projects on base, we're going to see a lot less parking available. So with that, if you see any vehicles that have been identified or appear to be abandoned, please let security know. We'll come up, we'll take a look at it. We're gonna put notices on the vehicles, and if there's no action taken to get that vehicle compliant, we're going to come tow it. That way you have more available parking to you. I'll turn it over now to Emergency Management.
Hey everyone, Mike Main, Emergency Management. September is National Preparedness Month, so what are some things that you can do to be better prepared? One, sign up for alerts and warnings. We talked about this a little bit at the last town hall, but our CDMS system, our Facebook page, all the different ways you can get notified of what's going on base. Hopefully you saw some of the things about the typhoon or the tropical storm that's coming in tomorrow. Make a plan. So just have a plan in place for your family. So in a disaster emergency, you have communication with your family, you know where you're meeting, you have that plan in place. Safeguard documents, so things like ID cards, passports, social security cards, any of those important documents, just have copies of those, have the original documents, keep them stored somewhere safe. Making your home safer. So one of the things you can do with that is put anchors on some of those heavier pieces of furniture. So when we have those shakes here in Japan, we get a lot of kind of smaller earthquakes. Is that those things are anchored to walls, so they're not falling over. Assemble our update supplies. Just make sure that the things you have on hand are not expired or ready to go, are easily transportable. Documenting your property, which is another one. So especially with PCS season, we should probably be taking pictures and ensuring all of our important stuff anyway. which is another way to kind of be ready for that. A few other things on here, so the NFAS, so make sure you go into NFAS, update your NFAS information. So if we do have to do some accountability, it's already in there, we know how to contact you. Your emergency evacuation program packet, so hopefully at AOB you've all got those packets, we're filling them out. If you haven't, they're available online on our website, but please go on, update that information, make sure it's all up to date. That way, in case we do need to get to that situation, it's ready to go also. The last thing on here is the Prepare with Pedro. So if you have smaller children, it's a fun campaign that American Red Cross put out. You can find it on the ready.gov website. It's got some colored books, some activities for younger kids to help them get into the preparedness mindset. So as Marissa mentioned earlier, your 72-hour emergency kits. So what are some things to put in those 72-hour emergency kits? We always talk about food and water, right? So water is typically a gallon per person per day. For some larger families, maybe interesting, you know, you have five people in your family, that's 15 gallons of water, that's a lot of weight. Be reasonable with it, right? Probably just a package of water is probably good to start with. Portable cell chargers, flashlights and batteries, first aid kits, can openers. If you have canned goods, make sure you have the can opener with you. Local maps, so for those of us that still can read paper maps, a lot of us can, make sure to have some local maps in case. You have money, prescription medicine, baby food, formula, pet food. The biggest thing to take away from this is really tailor that kit to what your family needs. Each family is going to have some different needs and different requirements, so just make sure you're building that kit to what your family needs for this. And the last thing on here is at the bottom are a couple websites to help if you need some guidance on how to build those kits, what should be in them, or just any emergency or disaster preparedness information. Ready.gov or ready.navy.mil are two great websites.
Hey, good evening everyone. I'm Chaplain Kim. I'm your friendly neighborhood chaplain. September is a very busy month over at the chapel, so I just want to highlight some of the programs that are restarting for the fall. So our Protestant movement of the chapel are continuing to meet. They're rebranding as the Women's Bible Study to make sure that they emphasize everyone is welcome, and that starts on Tuesday, September 12th. Our Awana's Clubs is a children's Bible study, a Bible group, club, that meets on Sunday afternoons, and that's starting up this weekend as well. And then our CCD, our Catholic Catechism, has already begun. But what we're really excited to announce is that we have a new chaplain on board, a rabbi, Chaplain Hamilton, and he has already started his Shabbat services, Friday evening services for our Jewish community. And September through October represents the High Holy Days. So we have a whole list of different services that are available for Rosh Hashanah, for Yom Kippur, and some days in between. And those are available on our Facebook site. So if you have this QR code here, it'll take you to our Facebook site. And on that Facebook site, you have different groups for different congregations. So feel free to click on those and to download the latest service schedules that we have over there. Some other things we wanted to point out for outreach throughout this coming quarter. We will be open. Friendship Day is on a Sunday, so the chapel will be open and receiving guests on that day. And then Thanksgiving, we're also opening our doors for a Thanksgiving dinner for our single sailors. So if you would like to volunteer and support that event for the sailors on the waterfront, please come out and do that. And then we have our annual International Christmas Celebration in the first Sunday of December. So again, lots of things going on, so they don't want to flood you with too much information, so please feel free to contact me for any of these programs, as well as any volunteer opportunities. We're always looking for motivated volunteers to help support the community. Thank you.
Before we open up to questions, I was going to give our NEX manager an opportunity to put anything out. No? All right. So. Turn this over to Leo.
Good evening. My name is Lieutenant Commander Sebas Pacheco. I am the CFA Staff Church Advocate. We had a few questions that were submitted prior to the event. We have five questions that I'd like to go over with the group. The first question was asking, what is the current CNFJ mask wearing policy? Here to let you know that CNFJ's new policy is that masks are no longer required. You may or may not choose to use a mask at your own discretion. Next is a question about whether any of the CFA facilities have a dress code. So currently, the only facilities on the base that have a dress code are the MWR-run gyms, So the requirement is that you wear appropriate athletic attire, and as Marissa said, closed-toe shoes for your own safety, unless you're in the pool, of course. But if you're looking for more guidance on what is appropriate athletic attire, if you go to the gyms on the bulkhead, there are examples there. And so we urge you to follow those examples. The next question, we have a person who's asking how they can gain access to Facebook groups that they've seen some of the members of the community use. So CFA is aware that there are some closed groups that are run by members of the community, meaning run by private individuals. Per Facebook's protocols, closed groups, you do have to, you know, request access from the group itself. And then that group, since it's a private entity, you know, can choose to grant you access or not. So if you choose to engage with those groups, we just remind you that, you know, as with any time you're interacting with a private entity, you do so at your own risk. It's your responsibility to use your own judgment about how you want to utilize their services or any information that those groups may provide. And it's also your responsibility to decide what kind of information you wish to share about yourself with those groups. We would like to also take this opportunity to let you know that, to remind you or let you know for the first time that CFA has implemented a new program called Sponsorship on Demand. This information about this program is currently going out in all new sets of orders to newly reporting individuals, but the purpose of this program is to ensure that accurate information is getting out to the community efficiently, and our website, the Welcome Reward Package on the CFA website has also been updated to include this information, and again, it's to make sure that people get accurate information about the community. And our last question is from a retired DOD civilian. This individual had some concerns because the retired DOD civilian ID cards are being phased out and will be discontinued. And some similar situated people may also wish to know how they can gain access to the base once the ID cards are completely phased out. So CFA does not have any guidance this time from higher headquarters, and until CFA receives such guidance, CFA will consider all access requests on a case-by-case basis, and will consider any exceptions to policy that need to be requested in order to allow individuals access to the base. And that concludes all of the questions, so thank you.
NWR also had two questions that were asked previously. And both of them were about two programs that we had previously offered here. One was Salsa Night at Club Alliance, and one was Bingo. And wondering if we were going to be bringing back both of those programs. We are happy to say that we are in progress of bringing back both of those programs. We're currently looking for a salsa contractor, and as soon as we are able to obtain one, we will be finalizing that contract and opening up classes again at our clubs. And we are currently also reviewing all of our Bingo program equipment mostly. It's been sitting for a while. We had to dust it off, test it out, make sure this part works and that part works. So we are currently ordering some new parts. As soon as we can get all of our Bingo stuff together working, we are really excited to bring that back to the community. We are aiming for early 2024 or sooner if we get the equipment here. So please look out for that. Thank you.
We also had a question about AFN dishes. The Navy Exchange, I'm Charlene DeVos, I'm the general manager of the Navy Exchange. We had a question about AFN dishes that we sold previously. We haven't sold them for 5 or 6 years now, so it took me a little bit of time to track down the management that was in Yokosuka at that time. We phased out due to our distributor no longer manufacturing that AFN dish. When we stopped selling them, so did APs. Well, APs has since found a contractor. We've reached out, so they'll hook our buying teams up with them. This is the first request that I've gotten in the 2 years I've been here for AFN dishes. So if that's something that the public would like for us to bring in, I think most everybody gets them with food housing. But if you live off base and you need another avenue to get them, we can provide that if there's a need for it. So if you have any requests, just send them
over.
Okay.
So that was all our pre-provided questions for tonight. Is there any questions from the audience?
I have comments and concerns.
Okay. Well, sir?
You want me to come up or just stand up and start talking?
You can come up if you'd like, or you can stand up and talk.
My name's Jason Wilton. I work with the Navy Lodge. Came out of Nashville, Tennessee. Noticed that the USPS stopped using cash. I'm no longer able to do business with them unless I use a card. The amount of Facebook on this base is appalling. I am not allowed on there. I support the Constitution and they don't. Lack of American flags around this place is, it's awful. Japanese public works workers, the public works talked about cleaning and doing stuff. I work for the Navy Lodge, they don't do nothing. I've gone behind them 7 different times, they don't do anything. I've got pictures and videos of the AC units, of the all the black mold inside these buildings. It's disgusting that we allow people to stay in these buildings. I've only been here since December. I just can't believe that people allow this stuff to happen here. Just disgusting. And then the bike riders on the road that don't follow any rules. Groups of bikes just blowing through stop signs and nothing seems to ever be done about that. That's all. Thank you.
Well, listen, first of all, thanks for sharing that with us. We appreciate it when people come here and they bring things. And please rest assured, we'll follow up and follow through on every one of your concerns.
I'd be willing to speak with any of you.
Well, that's wonderful. It's the first time we're hearing about some of these things.
I understand.
So, just believe you me. We'll follow up and follow through on it. We'll figure out what needs to be done, and if there's something wrong, we'll correct it.
I understand.
You know, we'll approach this, we'll put some light on the subject, and we'll see what we got. But I appreciate you sharing. Does anybody else have anything they would like to share? Please.
Sir, my question is for housing. I'm wondering what the current capacity is and if one-base living is still mandatory for everyone. I know there is a requirement for a certain percentage before living on base is optional. And then my other question is regarding the pilot program that was done in some of the towers for small dogs over the third floor. It was supposed to end in May, and then the results were going to be cut out to the community. I'm wondering if that survey has been completed and what the results are and the decision that was made regarding allowing smaller animals to go above a certain level of house.
Great.
I'm Kathleen Wells. I'm the personnel support director for housing. And for the first question was yes, it is mandatory assignment right now for all personnel inbound. So if we can fit your family composition, we have availability, we will assign you to on-base housing, whether it's at Ikego or here at Yokosuka. You have to be at 95%. You have to stay there steady. We just can't keep dipping. If we keep dipping, we're still going to keep assigning. But once we get steady at 95%, we will offer to go off post, off installation. And about the small pet, I'm not sure if you know about the small pet program, the pilot program. I'm not sure about it. I think they did.
For the small pet program, I just got done talking with the housing director about this 2 weeks ago. There was zero demand for it. That's why it went away. There was zero demand. And if there is a demand, please somebody get in contact with us with housing and let us know. But right now the demand was zero. So because the demand was zero, the pilot program is disestablished. That's what happened. Are there any other questions? All right, guys, thanks and have a great evening.
Thank you.